Rio Tinto to E-Trade, there's no shortage of speculation as to which companies could be prime picking for M&A. So what will be driving the activity for the rest of 07 and 08? Let's ask Sean Baldwin, Chairman and CEO of Capital Management Group. Sean, a very good morning to you. And it's interesting, you know, we used to think of M&A as driven when companies felt good about themselves and their prospects. Now, of course, you have all of these financial buyers taking smaller stakes. What is the overall view for M&A today?
The overall view for M&A is, in a short soundbite, smaller deals, but pretty much the same volume. If we look at the total deal volume, M&A from 06 to 07, June 30, 06 to 07, is down roughly about 6.1%. That roughly can be accounted for the lack of mega deals. The mega deals have kind of went away from the landscape. However, 70% of the deals are really middle market and private company deals. And these compromise, like 70% of the transactions are going that will still go on. Those really aren't going to be affected by the credit crunch.
Yeah.
There is some friction, but it's not due to the subprime, that's other than just general fear.
Well, that suggests the mega deals weren't such a good idea.
Yep. Most people agree that the mega deals aren't that good of a deal. People have a difficult time with integration. They're left with legacy assets that they really don't know what to do with. There's personality issues in management. So you see a number of companies, say like with Google, acquiring mass amounts of people because they're trying to generate more organic growth.
Sean, I got to say I'm skeptical. I mean, you're not the first to say this. I mean, we had someone from Clayton Dubilier Rice come on and say the same thing, that we're going to see smaller deals, but the volume isn't going to go down. And these mega deals were mega deals. I mean, we're talking
right.
50, 60, 70 billion. You're telling me we're going to make all of that up in small little deals? I find it hard to believe. So
convince
me.
To talk to you, the skeptic, Aaron, I'll say this. First of all, there's a couple of things that have changed in the landscape. First of all, you've got the capital markets are not what they were. You also have a landscape that has changed to a dramatic event because institutional plan sponsors, who usually were the limited partners in these deals, they're seeking higher returns in infrastructure transactions abroad. All the growth is really going to come ex the U.S. So these guys aren't there, the bread and butter, these other guys to come in and say, hey, you know what?
We've got a deal with you. So it's deals outside the U.S.
Outside the U.S. You
okay.
just came back from Dubai. Infrastructure in that region alone is going to be $160 billion over the next 5 years. $160 billion.
Now you've convinced me. You got the international component. That does it.
The international component.
But you've lost me. What does infrastructure have to do with this?
Infrastructure has to do with the capacity. If you look at teachers, CalPERS, you know, I've held a couple conferences in Qatar. I've taken the chairman of Texas Teachers. I've taken the chairman of New Jersey. $120 billion and $108 billion fund, respectively. They're going there to partner with the plan sponsors in those regions because the greatest growth, over 40%, first of all the booms in the world, are in Dubai. That's where the growth is occurring. So as they build roads, bridges, they're taking their 80-plus oil and they're translating it to infrastructure. And we have the double whammy effect with those guys because these sovereign funds now value the U.S. as very, very discounted assets, right? Assets that generate revenue, which is not the previous story that used to occur. So they're attempting to try to focus on developing their own portfolios so that they can generate revenues in the future as well as build up their country.
All right, Sean, thank you very much. We appreciate your joining us.
Thank you. Thanks for
Sean Baldwin joining us.